Peace and love, Royal Family. You know, let me see. We're talking about ascending and, you know, the astral world and yourself, your mind, your brain, who you are. Who's God? What are aliens? What are entities? What's your purpose here? Are we doing what we're supposed to do? Or is there an opposing force to us? Who's white people? And what's their purpose? Who's black people? What's their purpose? Do they serve the same purpose? You know, it's like this world got a lot of frequencies to it, you know, and a lot of us, we only care about like the basic features or the basic frequencies, ones we could acknowledge, but like there's a lot more going on, and the lot more counts more than the ones we pay attention to, you know, like for instance, I mean, there's differences between everybody, even though we all look the same. Everybody is different. And I'm not just meaning different as far as, you know, biochemistry-wise. I mean different as far as, like, you might look on the outside like something, but inside you're something else. And so a lot of people have a lot of cognitive dissonance within themselves all throughout their life. It's normal to have duality, but it's not normal to like go through it for a long period of time. All right, so let's try to put some sense to all of this now. I mean, not saying I'm any different from anybody else, but there was a point in my life where nothing really mattered to me as long as I was happy, you know, I was making money and trying to do right through the eyes of everybody, including my heart, my compassion. You know, I never had no desire to do wrong, never to hurt nobody. So, you know, that's what it is. But now, in all of this, something changed in my life. And it was like, you get like a sort of like a wake up. And this wake up changes you, and this change now is like you didn't plan to change, or you know, you didn't have any concept of what consciousness is, you know, the gods or any of that stuff. And so all of a sudden these concepts starts coming into you, these intuitions start overwhelming your mind, like downloading. And the thing to it is, it's kind of weird because you could ignore it. I mean, we've been getting it from as soon as we're able to be conscious that we're kids or we're here. You had those downloads coming, but for some reason it wind up being like a third sense, a sense that we probably pay attention to once in a blue moon. And the reason why we only pay attention to it once in a blue moon is very important, because we have another us. You know, you got your brain, you got your mind, you got your heart, got a brain, and your solar plexus got a brain. All of these is different obstacles in your life. These is obstacles. They're not actually what we think they are. Now, like, to give you an example, if I tell you 1 + 1 = 2, all right, 2. So you know now, you go to school and they quiz you 1 + 1, you'd be like 2. You're like, oh, you're smart. You're not smart. You didn't learn nothing. No, not at all. You could take it to the highest level of anthropology to, you know, a doctor. No. You didn't learn nothing at all. No, don't think so. You see, the way it's not even seems. I was going to say seem, but the way it is, you got to look at it for what it is. You understand? You're given some information and then quizzed on it to see if you know the information they gave you. That's all it is, really. It's not a sense of you have wisdom, knowledge, understanding, any of these things. Even if you was to do it 100 years and you mastered the quiz that they gave you and you learned from it, you improved it, you famous for it, that won't give you no type of wisdom, intelligence, or afford you to know who you are, much less know the environment is around you and what, how to interact with it, what is it about. It's a different whole other subject. So with that in mind, you could say most of us is thinking we're awake, but we're not awake. To us, dreaming is awake, and we never knew what being awake is, so you're dreaming. But then you read a book on how to be awake, dreaming, and then you, yeah, I got it, I follow it now. But now you still don't realize you never woke up to actually do it. Because a lot of the books we read and the authors we read, they themselves never really did those things in the book. When you do something theoretically, or I'm here applying myself, telling y'all something, it's not the same as if I was to show you something. You know, if I show you something, not only do you know how to do it too now, but it will motivate you to want to learn. You see, but when you read something that's about theoretical stuff, it comes into you. Maybe you absorb 2% out of it, but basically all the information get pushed to the back or left, and it become good conversation piece to make you seem like you know something. But in actuality, you're doing the same thing you was doing before you knew it and still after you do it. So, you know, the process of getting information to make you better, it's not literally like how we're doing it right now. We're just getting the information to think that we're getting smarter. But it's two folds to it. You have to apply it, because if you don't apply it, you're not going to be able to come out yourself. It's like I could sit here and we could talk about your neighbor, your friend, or whatever, but you never experienced them. You don't know them. You don't know what they've been through. So we really can't talk about them because we don't know them. But we'll sit here and we'll talk about people all day and don't care about really the cause and effect, if anything. But those is important, because if these little bullshit that I'm telling you about seem kind of boring and it don't make sense, you got to realize that's how they get you. You see, it's a subtle energy. This, everything in life is a very subtle force called psyche or consciousness. It's the first light, you could say. Look at it like, you know, in the Kabbalah, you have different ways. And one thing with Damien Samuels, you're going to learn, and it's not just through me, it's through the ancestors. Like, I'm just using the word Kabbalah. We're not trained to do that. That's against the rules, and it's crazy. Like, and I say we, and there's rules, you know, how is that? Yeah, there is. So Kabbalah is like a good system to understand just about yourself, your mind, everything around you. Well, you know, they wrote it on that purpose because they took and gathered all the information, magic, philosophy, science, mathematics, everything you could say, and incorporated into a system called a Kabbalah. You know, it's really old from like the Hermetic times, and the Hermetic, it's a Hermetic system, it's a Gnostic system. It's magic, it's black magic, left hand path, everything, third grade magic, all of it is combined in one. And I'm not here to promote Kabbalah because, like I said, ancestors don't have us talking about it. But, you know, in the Kabbalah, they do have this thing called the Ein, you know, the Ein, that's the first. And we'll call the Ein you in your purest form. You in your purest form is going to be, believe it or not, nothing. Nothing at all. And that's what Ein is, the nothing. You would be perfect, a state of, if you was to look at it, anything you would say or try to define it as, you're going to put a constraint in it. Put it in a circle. When you define something, you don't define what's in there. What you're doing is constraining it around laws. So now it becomes that which you define. So a state of nothing is perfection. It's undefinable. So that's why we call it the Ein. You know, I'm not saying we, because I'm not a Kabbalist. I'm not Kabbalah. I don't follow the Kabbalah. But you know what? When I was looking for myself, or trying to touch these experiences that I have, and what is it? You know, I'm no different from anybody. I was born green, believed in religion, and, you know, Catholic Church and all that. Well, I wouldn't say I believed in religion, because when you're young, you don't have no beliefs. You're just forced into something from culture. You see your parents did it, their grandparents did it, so you went to church too. You had no choice. Then when you got older and you did have a choice to keep the culture of what you was missing from a child and what y'all did, you continue the culture, but really never questioned it. Or went outside the Bible and read other books and brought it to the church, to the pastor, to everybody to question it. Whoa, I sure did that. They used to hate me, but he loved me so much, man. Let me tell you, that man, I went from questioning him about the law, you know, because everybody got the Ten Commandments and their law of Ma'at. Then when you start going into like stuff like Hammurabi, I tell him, give me the 300 law codes of Hammurabi. So he brought it to me, and we ciphered it out, and you get to see the Ten Commandments is in there, the 43 laws of Ma'at, even if it's a 400 and something laws of Ma'at, it's still all in there. Everything is in there. And you know the crazy shit is, this was supposed to be in, Assyria and all of them, you know, Hammurabi is supposed to be the king of all the four corners. That's another story. But anyway, his law code is more famous because he's given it by this god named Shamash, and his stele, they got the law code of Hammurabi, they got a stele of him on his knees, and Shamash is sitting on the throne giving him these scrolls, you know, and he's accepting it. So those law codes is over 300, and you got now, every culture had law codes. Every city-state had to have law codes. So you had Ur had law codes. You could look them up. The Lagash had law code. Kemet had law code. Egypt had law code. Everybody had those commandments. It's not like it was written by a god. It was written by the state or the king, pharaoh, head body, priests. Everybody have to have a law code if they were a civilized nation. So, you know, that was my point I wanted to prove to that pastor, to let him understand that it's not something divine. And when you look at the 10 is in every system prior to that. But you only know about that, and it's not 10. Just like the law code of Hammurabi predate Moses and the Ten Commandments by over 1,000 years. So I just want you to understand that we can't get caught up in our superficial mind of what we consider to be true, you know, and we shouldn't think that, oh, I don't care, I have my beliefs, you have your beliefs. It don't work like that. There's something over us watching this, and it's pushing everything in a direction. It's sifting everything out too as it falls through the sifter. Things is falling in different places where they belong. And that's the thing to it. You put yourself in a position. You made your choice. And your choice you make is going to determine your future. And so, with that in mind now, you know, this thing we're doing with religion or whatever the case may be, it's not as simple as we think. And even our beliefs, it's not as simple as you think. You can't just say you believe what you want and I believe what I want. That's the whole trick to it, because then let's look at, you got your Illuminati and your higher groups. They believe something totally that is not in your category of selections for beliefs. And they don't have a belief, they have a no. You see, that's when you pass that set level of what we call belief. Belief now, you look at it more, or I believe as two people that, first of all, don't see eye to eye. One. Two, if you was to go to a court of law and tell the judge you believe this person raped you, or you believe this person robbed you, your court case will be thrown out, because if you didn't know he robbed you or raped you, it's no case. You know, so that gives you an understanding that there's no jurisdiction in beliefs. You understand what I'm saying? When you say you believe something, you're really saying, I don't know. Instead of you saying, I don't know, you said, I believe. So it's only right to you inside. It don't mean it's right. So that counts more than what you have inside of you alone. You're not you, you're everything. You're part of the whole, you're the all. So if you're going to be part of the all, you would have to see everything on a universal level, because everything is an extension of yourself. But not this you. When we talk about us, you know, that's a whole nother topic again now, because we look at ourselves from the physical outside. You know, it's the oldest mythology in the world. I think it was Narcissus. All of these saw their images and the reflection and fell in love with themselves. And, you know, we actually forgot who we are. That's all it is. You know who you are. And it actually became your demon, the devil, that shit that chased you in your dreams, because you fell in love with the flesh, the material world. And, you know, you have a mind that is have a conscious side and a subconscious side. You might think you control it, but inside of it, there are living entities that is dealing with themselves. The conscious mind is trying to just focus on your belief of the vanity and of the material world, that thing that you looked in the reflection and fell in love with, your physical. The subconscious, that's your soul. That's been here for millions from the beginning. It's infinite. And it's at war with you, because you're the cockpit control pilot, but you got them in the background not living. And they're the truth. While you're out here pretending, wearing a whole bunch of masks all day, every day, just because of your image. Run into the store to change it up, get your hair done, go get your barbershop done, and get new outfits, go get some more money, new rims, new car, new system, whatever, to keep it going, keep it going, keep it going. One day you're going to die, though. Your car is going to sit there, your hair is going to have to come off your head, your eyelashes. You know, all these things, your money is gone, it goes to your kids who repeat the cycle that you just did over, because you left that for them. You don't let them actually earn their own, work to see what it's like. You give it to them, just like our oppressor gave it to them. And look at them, they're inconsiderate people now that is telling you, well, that's old stuff, forget about that. Why are you bringing up old problems and making it into this new one? We're all one. We're all the same. But a lot of us is poor, and they're not. They're reaping the rewards of the benefit of our hard work, sweat, and labor. Nobody never said, here, let's balance it out. Take half of this. I got more than enough. You know, but yet they'll donate it to schools, hospitals for diseases, to poverty, to you name the society or the nonprofit, they'll donate it to that, but they won't help nobody that somebody can say, hey, this person is a good person, regardless of what they say. You know, an individual help is better than just having a great thought of helping and, you know, keeping yourself up in business and red tape. So these things that we believe inside now is not what it is. You have another world, a whole other world of that subconscious spiritual side that conflict with you inside to cause the duality. So, in it now, this is where all the problems is going to get deeper as we, you know, make understanding of everything. Well, in this system that you got now where you believe what you want to believe, and then there's truth. You have that truth that is always going to be up in your ass conflicting with you. So what wind up happening is, it first comes to you before you even embark upon what you're going to be deceiving yourself about. The truth of it came to you before that. It was your first intuition, your first thought. And so what wound up happening, we second guess that. You, the individual, is not the actual intuition. Which you are the intuition, but you're not the intuition right now. So what you do when you hear it, you second guess it. I'm going to do it this way. I'd rather do this. You know, when you do that, you give up or you forfeit yourself. Because that was you, the first one. The second one was not you. The second one is a raised, culturized you. The one that's more left brain, which controls the right thinking, the rational side of you. And now you're rationalizing with spirituality, your intuition, yourself. You see, everything is like animal. We're animal first. So you're instinctive by nature, mostly acted out, especially in your emotions. We're very emotional creatures because right now we still haven't evolved past the fire in our levels of maturity and growing. And to master fire is to master your emotions. So we're very competitive. We are jealous. You know, we have envy, ego, lust. All these things is all based in an emotional body. These things now make you up, not you, the real you. Factoring, culture, how you was raised, your ambition, how you want it. How much you want out of life makes the attitude and the will you have and the compelling force that compel you to go out and do these things. So now you have that, that makes the new pseudo you. You could say too, let's add a fake pseudo soul and a pseudo spirit to go with it. So you're in yourself and created a whole individuality, like how in the beginning, the darkness and the light came and the light separated from the darkness. It was one, but from the two, you got a whole universe. There's multiple universes, so you don't see it in yourself and how you create these things unless you look from outside yourself. So now, you're going around with a pseudo you because it's kind of weird. We live in a society that, you know, it's like you have a group community consciousness, you know, a social grouping. And this now, for it to take place, have to be one idea, one ideology, one nation under one government, you know, all that good stuff. And so we have to agree upon this reality. Like, is this a war? Everybody say yes, then it's a war. Is this black? Everybody said yes, and I agree it's black, then we say it's black. And we navigate through life like that, but it doesn't mean it's true. So, what wind up happening now? We socialize on the basis of these so-called realities or actualities. Say, everybody who agrees that that's a war. They all, hey, yo, how you doing? Yo, everything good? Yeah, you're great, good, good. The ones who agree that this is black, hey, yo, everything is good? Yes, great, great, right. Let's write books on the walls. Let's write book on a black shirt. You know, that's how we live. We do that for 10, 20, 27 years. When you reach like the 27th, 29th, and finally the 30th year, everything starts to change. It's not nothing was wrong with the beginning. We have to grow. You know, us growing and the animal growing is the same. It's always been compared to from by Sigmund Freud to C.J. Jung to a lot of great minds, philosophers, to understand who we are. Now, in it, you will see that you were born just the same way, you know, as a cub, you feed on the breast like an animal do. You know, you start to run and wrestle like cubs with your brothers and sisters. You start to now date just like the lion do, go around fucking other lions. So you have multiple relationships, learn your ability as a goddess or a king. And eventually you start learning how to fight, defend the land, you know, just like the animal. Everybody go through it. It's if you could understand just those parts I just put together, then you see the comparison between the animal kingdom and the human kingdom. It's the same soul, same evolutionary process, you know. And so you first have to go through that. That's why I said it's like, you know, those is all right, that's regular, but you have to revisit it now. It runs out. It's only a level to it before it gets repetitive. It repeats itself a few times before 30. But at 30, the sacral bone goes. That's the one that looked like a spade. And once that sacral bone connects, you have now a kundalini thing going on. The whole bone system of your back. You know, I don't want to get you lost. It's been termed because, like I said, I have to give you navigational devices. I can tell you things because that's what I do. I'm not here to quote out of a book or tell you what another author says. I'm telling you from my experiences what I know. Now, I read books. No, I don't read a whole book. I jump through some books at a time, looking for what has something to do with my experience. And once I find it, then I could bring it to you. Because I could sit here and tell you stuff, but you wouldn't understand it. It wouldn't make no sense to you. It's like if I took you to the moon and showed you things on the moon that, you know, from a distance, good enough distance that you can't actually make it out. Like all the videos you see when they're like, this is a tower, this is a base, and you're looking like, okay, you know, and they're looking at the azimuth and the shadows and how the sun, it's, yeah. Well, it's the same thing when you go into other things, other places, deal with other peoples, other worlds. You can't really bring it back and tell people because we look for definition, explanation, but for us, we just take you there. We just show you. Then you know, like the Egyptians do. They're knowers. You know, they know from the experience. They never wrote the books. I mean, they never read the books. They wrote the books. It's a difference. When you read in the book, you're looking for an explanation. That's how I do it. When I'm researching, I'm looking for something to make an explanation. But if I'm experiencing, I'm writing and putting down my experiences, how it went. So, when we start now getting this information and we put it in books, it's not like the same, because when you do that, it's like now we all read these books, and these books is kind of an experience, but not an experience. You do experience it inside as if you definitely open up portals and you was there, or it opens up portals and you get a better perception. But there is another part to experience that is called instincts. There's instincts built inside of you, afforded to you, downgraded to you, upgraded to you, downloaded while you're sleeping, that you have to actually have the experience. And action is taking place for the instincts to be kicking in and you acknowledge it. Because it could have it in you, but you never used it. You could read a book, imagine it, but you never used it. Alright. Now, these instincts that I'm talking about now, everybody have a whole bunch of them. It's like your instincts come from someplace else. It was always yours and it been here for a long time, but we never really had it because it was never really put into activity. You could say it's like a muscle, or you could say the neurons that connect it or whatever, it's withered, it's weak, it has to work out. It needs you to remember. And then once you remember, it fires up and connects it. You know, now, the thing is, there's parts to your neurons that make this happen. How is that? Because you realize neurons is electronics, lights, you know, magnetics. And so, for you to activate these things, you have to deal in one of those categories. The only thing that is light is two things, your consciousness and your soul, your spirit, too. These things right here is the key to actually activating your neurons to make you remember how to do these things. They call them different names, you know. Being that we're talking about the Ein and the nothingness, it's like, you know, there's a second part to it. I guess we could start that now. But you understand the concept of nothingness is you. That's who you are in your perfect state. Then from there, you emanate. This is what's called the Ein Sof. The three rays of light, or the seven rays. They call them the seven rays because they come with baggages. These three rays of light is what's called the Trinity. Your mother, father, and son. They're literally actually you in three different forms. You have, from the nothingness, a ray of light comes out. This ray of light now starts to acknowledge itself. That's part two of the Trinity. Knowing your existence. And after it acknowledges itself, it says, hey, I'm real. It starts being. Now you're being. You're actually part of creation. You wouldn't say physical. Mind now. Mind is here. The mind of what? The mind of... Yes. Okay. The mind of the all, we're going to say. Consciousness. So the nothing, or the dark abyss, you would consider it God, the all, the controller, the source, dark light, most high, whatever your theory is, Allah, you. You pure natural. Here, we don't individualize anything, so the you don't count. Because you remember, if it was you, you would have been the nothing before the nothing was nothing. So you came from the nothing means you're not the nothing, you're part of the nothing. So now, this light comes, now you're coming into being. You get the I am thing. Oh, okay, I am. So what are you now? Those three lights in dark space, matter, electricity, magnet, it makes up what's called consciousness. All three, you need the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Mother, Father, Child. You knowing, and you being. That's the true form of it. Now you're talking about the light. The light that shines upon the world. You're looking at the Savior. Yeah, the final name for it, Christ. Those three lights is Christ, your consciousness. So this consciousness now, or Horus, is really you, alert, awake, knowing. You see how there's no book to read, there's no story to write, but it's like you know. So knowing is being. Being is awareness. Who are you? You're aware of your being. That's who you are. Energy that is aware. The physical body now. That energy, being aware, it's aware that it could take form. That's why you have the Book of Formation in there. So now, with taking form, there's a lot of rules to it. It's a lot of rules to just taking form. You just don't take form. I wish we could. Let's see if I could change form real quick. No, it don't work like that. Take form is a process. Look at it like how you looked as a child and how you look as an adult. That's formation. Formation now. Before we go into formation, we need to finish off because we're still now at consciousness. You're not here yet. You're just first emanating from the light. And you become now conscious, the Christ. The Christ now is not Jesus, but Jesus represents the Christ. Anyways, we'll get into that later. But now, you're looking at consciousness and its existence. And now it starts to get attributes. For you to be in its formation, you need attributes. It's all frequencies now that's going to make consciousness come together like a light rainbow. And in the center core, the more you compress it like a black hole, it emits light out, bright rays, radiance, until all of a sudden it calcifies in the center. But how is this possible? The first thing you're going to go through to accomplish this is consciousness. You're not alone in this whole system. So we're going to use the basic. We have what's called the Watchers, or the Metanetches, the gods, but not those gods. This is a different set of gods. These gods here govern the zodiac. The zodiac has everything to do with this, believe it or not. The zodiac give you imperfection. Your perfect soul, perfect consciousness, but ascending to what we call Earth, the Malkuth, you lose a lot of things. They're not sending you here perfect to come and fix this Earth. This is theirs. They made this for you to learn something on. It's pre-set up already, different destinations, different lessons. But first, through the zodiac, the 12, 1, 2, the 3 of consciousness, is added different things. This is what you call Chikaman, Binah, the Fahe. All these now become your envy, lust, pride, your everything to give you something to work to. So you ascend through all the zodiac signs, picking up all these hinderers. This is your characteristics, your personality. What's on the outer layer? So now you go from 3 to 6. Now from the 6 you start to descend into what's called now the underworld, or the world of what's called the separate, the body. You enter to what's called Daf, death. In the Kuvala, you have what's called the Das Gate. It's the center of the pineal. You enter through here through the seat of the spirit. What body you encounter, it has many forms. There's no particular one. You have the four forms, human formation. In its earliest stages, you was a microbe. You was a bacteria. You was the germ. You was the sea stuff. You was the plants later. Then you became the animals later. Then finally, their greatest creation, they put you, the seed of the soul of them, and the pineal. So you enter through the Daf gate, and you come into this body, this dimension. Wisdom is the one who affords you to be here. She's real. Wisdom, though, herself fell. Remember, in the Bible, that's in Proverbs, all that stuff, she's the first with God. Wisdom was there. That's right. It's a story with wisdom. You got to go into Gnosticism now. Gnostics. Learn about the Pistosophists. It's the wisdom. And they'll tell you the story of how when the light separated from the darkness tried to stop it. You know, the mother, the dragon, I call it. You know, you could call it whatever you want. God, you know, don't look at God as a man. God just stands for governor, organizer, destroyer. It's just a title. You can't name the unknown. You can't name nothing. So try. Our ancestors always made it a symbol. It's the best way to do it. That planet turned it sideways. And it became the four corners of our multiverse. Upper kingdom, lower kingdom, north, south, east, west. It's a very, 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 very important story science. It wasn't made up for directions, no. It was made up for inside of you. It became also what's known as the Merkaba Mar, the essence of you. Ka, the spirit of you. Ba, the breath of you. Those three combined to give you, take you back up. That's a clue. So now, and it's all Egyptian. This is not something that is like, you know, Hebrew or Jewish or something. No, no, this is all Egyptian. I guess, you know, we do so many videos. I know y'all should know by now. There is nothing that nobody owns out here. Everything is Egyptian. Everything. Look at the whole Washington, D.C., Paris, Rome. Everything is a replica of Egypt. Minds. Science. Don't ever kid yourself. Look at your money. You're in Egypt. It's way deeper than you think. Way deeper than you think. You still got the pharaohs here. Everybody's here. We're under Egyptian government. Anyways, so you you get back up through the, you understand now with the Sephiroth. This is the tree of life right here. You got two sides to the tree of life. You got the front side. This is the day side of the tree. What takes place in the first 12 hours of the AM. The sun makes its rotation from over, come around halfway, It's where you get the Ark from. The Ark. Moses and the Ark. Two of every animals. The Zodiacs. Halfway around the sun is the Ark as it travels through the 12 Zodiac animals. So you got the Ark right there. Did you make your covenant? Two animals is the ancestors. Did you make your covenant with the ancestors yet? You gotta understand it first. They're not gonna make it easy for you. I told you, they put some hindrances on you before you came. So you have to understand those first. Those is your desires, your lusts, your wantings. And the most important thing of all, suffering. Now, your pineal gland. Astrologically, it stands or is governed by Aries, the first sign, the real New Year. And so, you have to understand now that the pineal is the governor of everything here. Without the pineal, you wouldn't be able to see everything that is there, to see beyond this world. You wouldn't have the dreams you have. And so, the pineal is God to a lot of races, cultures back in the days. You seen it drawn in many pictures in many forms. It's like the flower of life, the cone that they hold, you know, it's the rose petals. Sometimes it symbolizes a dragon. It's all the pineal. It's a rock too. Those that had it connected back in the days was called Peters. Peters are portal openers. Openers. Jupiters. They open the rock. What's the rock? Well, when you enter the pineal world, the other world, it looked like you're facing mountains. And you go into the mountains, through the mountains, through the caves. So it's called the rocks. It looked like you're looking at a rock being. These rock beings is the Metanetras. I remember everybody is the Metanetras. Ain't never been translated, all this stuff. Metanetra was really just the watchers, the gods, the 12 signs of the zodiac. But they got a story though. It's a deeper story. And what they tell you in their translations is not it, because it's all actions. It's something for you to do, not something for you to read. You know, it's funny, I started ascending people through my pioneer, connecting with theirs. And I asked them, what did they see? And most of them would say what happened, the journey they took on. Somebody took them here, then they went over here, and somebody said, what are you doing here? Who told you to come here? Who invited you? So I did that probably like 3 times and got that response that they said, what are you doing here? You're not supposed to be here. And I made them break the meditation and I break the pineal connection. But they seen things they never believed. Never believed. They float about themselves and enter circles. That's a porthole. Zoom through it faster than the speed of light and come out someplace else. Most of the time, it's a gatekeeper standing there, man with a crown, purple, with the oil, with a diamond in his foot, a ruby, and a chain on with a number, a medallion on. You have to pass him, the gatekeeper. And if you could pass them, you got to pass the Golden Dragon next before you could arrive anywhere. Well, that's the reason why I can't tell it to you how to do it. It's that simple. Very simple. But, like I said, there is adversity on my part. And it could cause problems to the person who did it if their mind is not strong. So it's not something that I could say, hey, do this and do this and it's done. I've done that. And some people's just not invited there or not ready. So, you know, don't get me wrong. This has to be stretched out this way, and I could do it. Now, that was my original plan, just to give you quick little scrolls of instructions, bang, bang, bang. But upon getting punished for bringing people up there who wasn't supposed to be up there, I learned it's not everything is for everybody, and you have to try to achieve it yourself. And like I said, most of us is not going to understand until you put suffering into it. Everything is achieved through Aries. Remember the pioneer. Pioneer Aries is the ram, the lamb. When we see the lamb, we don't know it's Aries, the sign, much less do we know the story. We associate it biblically because they used it to brainwash you because they knew what was coming in the future. They had the prophecies. So they made the Bible to counter the prophecies. And we all fell for it. So anyway, Aries, the lamb, is the suffering servant. If you can't suffer, you can't be a sore loser, you can't take an ass whipping and say, all right, we're good, you can never get there. The suffering servant is the most important aspect to get out of this world. Most of us is born with a silver spoon in our mouth. We don't know what it is to suffer. We don't have no empathy. The soul is not going to rise. So, the pioneer has to go through suffering for it to activate. It's the only way. It's like post-traumatic stress disorder. And I'm not telling you go out and go hang yourself, go waterboard yourself, go drown yourself or anything like that. I'm saying maybe you need to outgo more so you can have more experiences, follow your destiny. I was telling you about intuition before. Everything is downloaded. If you was to just be your intuition, not follow it. When you follow it, you're second-guessing yourself. You got an evil, very evil side. It's very evil. If you read any books, especially Gnostic books, the only evil person in the world is a human being. They're against a human being all the way. Because we was raised by our culture, and we believe what we want. You're going to run your mouth and say what you was taught. In reality, you already know everything, but you know nothing. Not you. The one back here know everything. The subconscious soul. So when you, people that's Gnostic hear somebody ribbering and rabbering, we can't give you answers because you have the answers within yourself if you was to be silent. Go back to the aim, to the nothing. There, everything is a big collage. Anything that has you see in there has something to do with your life. From the Big Bang to now. So, if you don't understand these things and you try to define it, explain it, you're going to get lost. Because defining, explaining is constraining. Every time you do that, you lose the meaning of it. It's that we come from a period in time that we lost everything and we don't care because nothing have anything to it. So science is nothing. Think about it. What do you know in science? What has science done to benefit you not from a material sense, inside of you. Nothing. Medicine, medical, nothing. It's no cures. They could treat you. You could go outside, grow a herb, and do that yourself. Do you know how? Do you know what each herb do? Just like the pharmaceuticals use it to make up their medicine, then cut it, or synthesize it and make it generic, or whatever you call that word. You got to know these things. You can't be here on this earth for nothing. They got you in a concrete jungle. We're in a concrete jungle. We don't know nothing that's going on. We're being tailored to, they cater to us, room service to us, and just tell us, work, all right, keep going. You see, everything is afforded to you, the silver spoon in the mouth. When they do this to you, and calamity happens, you have no other choice but to run to the government. That's what they want. As long as you run to them, you have to vote, you need them, you have to participate. Your participation is needed, so they make wars, conflict, even take your kids to go in these pretend wars. Your TV always show you that on TV. But from your grandparents' life and everybody else, everybody been living comfortable. America never been attacked. If you look at Pearl Harbor, you know that was in Hawaii, first of all, but it wasn't even an attack, it was orchestrated. But that's another story. I'm just giving you examples, really, so you understand. Sometimes we think one way and it's not like that. So, in reality, at the end of it all, when you get these attributes from the Zodiacs, it's like you grow up and you wind up now reaching to the 21 years old, 27 years old stages. You start having these changes. By the time you're 30, the sacral bone grows. You connect all of the missing parts of your spade bone to make it connect to your thalamus, your pituitary, and your pineal. Now, all you need is some power, some energy. This power energy is called your semen, your cum. You allow that to mature. As it matures and through reading and understanding what you're reading, understanding truth, it's not just regular like how you think. That's the hardest part about it. You have to have an inner sense of truth already. You cannot be lost and have everything just pulling you around. You have to have a sense inside of you of something to chase, something to believe. And you go and search if that's true, an intuition that tells you already. That will start your real mission. Research what it's telling you inside or question what it's telling you. Once you do that, you will see then that was what the true essence of researching, finding out what you need to know will make you have something original to bring to the tables. You know, if you didn't experience it, it's very hard to tell about it. You know, and it's very hard to explain it too from another person who experienced it if the other person didn't experience it. So, with that in mind, then now, let's see. Once you get this Kundalini energy flowing through your system, you all of a sudden now get your daf gate back open. Your pineal, even if it's calcified some, is getting nutrients again to start decalcifying. It's like an eye, you know what I'm saying? If they could get rid of cataracts off your eye, your pineal could decalcify by itself. Smoke marijuana. I don't suggest it. I wouldn't even do it because, you know, a lot of y'all, it's like another thing. But they do say that decalcify it. You know, don't use toothpaste. I tell you that much. But these are basic stuff. I don't need to be wasting my time or your time. But anyways, once you do get yourself all the bones connected and, you know, you're able to ascend to a certain level through not having sex, abstaining for a little while. I'm not saying a long time. Maybe if you're about 30, 34 or younger, you know, wait 3 days or maybe once a week. That's good. If you want to really be real, just ride it out till you find what you're looking for. But these all build up, you know, energies. It makes you have a good charge and you have a greater compressed fractal climax. This helps to loosen out the soul. But anyway, at the end of it all, once you're able to do that and everything connects, you have these experiences, you'll be able to have out-of-body experiences, you travel, everything happens then. You got to realize, you know, it's funny, all of us see the Egyptians when they have their headdress on or whatever, they always cover up their pineal. Your pineal is like a secret weapon. You know, you don't reveal your pineal. That's why they cover up their pineal. The snake and the uterus and all that don't mean nothing. It just means they're covering their pineal. It don't mean their pineal is active. Everybody's pineal was active back then. But they're covering it because they're higher beings. They was trained by higher people. So their pineal do not what the average person pineal do. So, once you realize all of this now, then you can get your ascension going, the process start, and the gods start coming back to you. The zodiac sign, that is, and start taking off these things off you that they put on you before you got here, or on your journey here. And so that's when now you start becoming what they call an ascended master light being, which you always was, but those things constrained you, or was a governor switch on you to stop you. But you have to make the transition. You have to not want to do those things no more. You haven't had enough of that, and you're ready to be deity. Deity is God. God is by himself. He don't have nobody. He just do what he has to do and help people. And that's what you're all here for. You know, I'm not saying everybody that, but you got a lot of people who just want to watch football, laugh, and play and hurt people. And you have to be careful of that, because these people is what's out here, and they're your distraction. These people have no purpose. They're just here to reincarnate. That you only have 108 reincarnations, which is 9 times going around the zodiac. You understand what I'm saying? Once you do that, there's no more reincarnations for you at all. So everything got to cease, and it comes to an end in that sense. That if you haven't accomplished it by 108, you did something else going to happen. You have to look into that for yourself. I'm not here to be reading books and teach nobody out no books. And what I want to teach, I ain't even start yet. I'm just trying to give y'all a little blueprint so you have understanding. You know, the world that we come from is real, you know. And if you don't follow the Gnostics, the Gnostics is the only truth. The Kabbalah lies, it's there. If you understand it, like I broke down the whole thing using the Kabbalah. The Kabbalah lies, all that Ein Sof and Tiptoff and all that and Kefra. Who the fuck wanna take the time out to do all that? You see, now I'm getting into my ghetto self now. Because that's another thing. You get on into that, it's a big waste of time. I could show you a different way, but I can't explain it to you. It's weird. It's just bugged out. Plus, ancestor won't let me. So, anyways, that's why I guess for me, the Gnostic give you so straight up that you think it's a fantasy, a fairy tale, but in actuality, it's the truth. You understand what I'm saying? So, you got to be more Gnostic. If you're black, Gnostic is the way to go. Because it's all spiritual, it's all about the soul, and it shows you a lot that you need to know. So, on that note now, you know, get into the Gnostic teachings and you'll learn more about everything, because the reason why I know it is because I deal a lot with entities, spirits, you know, every time. I'm on a very high level of meditation. I work behind the scenes. I could tweak and do some funny things. It's a lot. I don't want to be here because I'm not here to brag about nothing. You know, people who know me know what it is already. But what I'm saying is that when you have these weird experiences, you're not going to be able to equate it to nothing unless you read a Gnostic book. Gnostic book also tell you how to carry yourself to get you to the higher levels. It shows you how not to be soulless or act like a soulless one that think you're going someplace and think you have a soul but don't. And you got a lot of people too who have a soul and didn't know that they have a soul and experiencing shit and be like, oh, this is weird, or what the fuck is this? Yo, I don't understand. And it's on drugs, on mental hospitals, seeing psychiatrists, just because they have a soul. And they were so low that they couldn't make the transition. I was like that, but I didn't have all that other stuff. I had to go kamikaze and figure out the hard way, be a warrior. And I believe a lot of people is going to be happening. So now this is a lot of big awakening going on. The soul is here. But, you know, it's not entities. It's not no goddamn aliens. It's not no demons. It's just you. If you don't realize who you are, you'll get lost in all this dogma, information, hotline, and the internet out here. But, you know, it's like these is going to be changes we're going through. And you have to accept it. You're going to see the Egyptian gods. You're going to see the Olympian gods. You're going to interact with them. There's nobody going to kill you. Nobody's going to cut you up. Nobody's going to harm you. And you have to realize that. I can't really go all into it because, like I said, this one was supposed to be a little mediocre down the line thing. But the whole thing to it is, man, what you could do once you're able to grasp the concept by having discipline yourself, clear your mind of the bullshit, leave all that desire shit, all that love shit alone. Not saying don't have a spouse, but you know, doing all that extra shit y'all motherfuckers be doing, y'all know what the fuck I'm talking about. Just keep that shit simple. You understand what I'm saying? Be true to yourself. If shit ain't popping, then don't let it go. I mean, don't get into it. Don't be with all that. If it is, then good. You know, life is choices, and you got to be able to make choices and change your mind. Now, aside from that, learning the science, all that stuff, you can't tell it. You got to show it. All that astral projecting, remote viewing, this and this and this, and the gods, you got to show it. None of those gods' names is their names. Not even none of that. Not Kemet, not Egypt, not Mizraim, not Nubia, not Ethiopia. Remember, any governing body, he tells the story. That's his story. So if you calling yourself the black land, the black, who would call themselves on the black land, the black land, if they didn't have another color to go against? It would just be the land. You have to have a white land to say the black land. You have to have a white person to say the black people. You can't have just you and not see another color and then call your shit a black land. No. It don't work like that. Think about it. So when y'all saying these names, think and listen to what it's saying. The author or the one who's saying that was an observer as a third party. He's not there. Some people, when you go there, would not have said that they're the black land. They wouldn't have said they're the black people. They wouldn't have said none of those things that has to do with any type of culture, color, anything like that. They wouldn't have known none of that stuff. They wouldn't have had no black nothing in there. They wouldn't have known what black was. I'm going to be straight up, because really, they lived in darkness. Look in the chambers, they lived in darkness. Everything was dark. Think about it. Don't let them play with your mind. So, anyways, we all overstanding all these stuff now and getting out this black dark shit. Because there's white people that's blacker than this motherfucker, and there's black people who think they're black, but they're really white. They can't do nothing, have no soul, no power, no pioneer. That's a fact. It's white people who's really black, who got a soul of pioneer and having the weirdest shit and is taking drugs. I know these things for a fact. I interview a lot of people and deal with a lot of people. And so you get to see it for yourself. It's amazing, but it's real. So you never know who's soulless, who's pioneerless. It could be your sister, it could be your mother, it could be your brother. You understand what I'm saying? Everybody chooses themselves. Some of them can have it and deny it. Some of them don't want it. Some people can't make the transition. It's a transition. The hardest part about this transition is that you have to be able to discipline yourself to release your yesterday baggage and come into the new. Because with the new, you can't, I'll give you an example. Like, I'm in the levels that I'm in and where I'm at, you can't be in there if your breath is stink. You can't be in there if you didn't bathe. You can't be in there if you drunk alcohol. All them stuff, them things come before you enter. You have to pass a gatekeeper. They come in front of you, and they're going to smell you. They're going to tell you, mm-mm, straight up. Everything poof away. You have to be clean. You have to know alcohol in your period. We don't drink spirit juice because it induces something in us that's not us. You understand? It brings what they're trying to take out of you, to cleanse you, back in you. We don't indulge with frivolous talk in the mundane world, not because it's not good and because you don't want to. It's because you're at a cusp of transitioning. It's like I take you to heaven and I say, here, write this down, but don't write it on paper. Write it in your mind. Remember everything. You understand? And I tell you, look, you don't have to write every word. Just write key words. Key words will help you remember these. I can give you 7 key words and you remember 5 books. So I give you the 7 key words. Now just sit for 5 minutes and remember these key words. Keep saying them. But you go now and you break in meditation. And you go, oh, your kids are over here and this is happening over here. Your girl calling you. You forgot all about it. Everything. So you see, the isolation, the not being around the mundane, give you an opportunity to learn the instinct of catching the 7 to make up the whole story. It's like they say a picture is worth 1,000 words. So all of a sudden, that's your job. It's not a hard job. It's not like they're asking you for everything. But you have to be able to grasp the concept. And that's why you separate yourself to grasp the concept, to learn something new. And then you come back. So ain't nobody telling you to isolate yourself and be in there praying and begging for nothing. No, it's none of that. You get your intuition, your thoughts, and you get some shit downloaded to you. And then you remember, and you remember how to do it. You remember to stay like that. So you always like that. It's not like you like the other person or the old you. You know, that's that old saying why they say don't put old wine in new wineskin. So you got to get rid of all of that for your transition. It ain't about nobody thinking they better than nobody. But you was taught wrong. You have to realize that. Once you realize that, this would be a better place for you to put yourself in a better position. These is called chapters in your lives. You know, I'm not blaming nobody, not no government. I'm blaming you, yourself, the choices. It's your choice. Nobody's going to put a gun to your head and nobody's going to make you do. You could go out here and advocate for this, advocate for that. Advocate for yourself, though. Without you, nothing is going to happen. So you first have to realize that you're the key to all of this. So once you realize that, you understand how isolation works. Isolation is only there to make you better. And if you don't want to be able to release yourself from your emotions, release yourself from your delusions, release yourself from your beliefs, then by you interacting with other people, you keep those same beliefs, those same ideas, eat the same foods, keep on being the old you. After time, consciousness had a shift. The world, the planets, and everything moved, but you stood there, and you're there by yourself. That's what's going on. You have a consciousness shift, and those that didn't take it, they're going to go down or shift over to what's called the third dimension, while other people's going over to the fourth dimension. And it's not no emotional thing. You can't help it. If you're going over here, you're going over here. You can't help it. If you're going over here, you could help it. You're supposed to be over here. It's nobody that's supposed to be over here. So these over here, I don't want to talk about them because it's not good. So anyways, that's what it is. And if you will choose, that's your business. You understand? But you can't impose it on other people, much less the other people over here. You're going to have a hard time watching the separation because these people is going to hurt you because they're going to look bad to you and you're going to feel sorry for them. Just nothing you can do about them because they can't wake up. Some of them is going to be actually zombies walking on earth because they refuse. Simple. Even just having kids. Sometimes you're so connected to your kids and you're emotionally connected in such a way that you won't even see what's best for them. You know, you just want to love them. And loving them is not raising them. Loving them is spoiling them. Anyways, I'm done for now. University of Conscious Science. Know the signs and you know that you was one of them.